stick on. We're ready? Okay. Let me just start recording for Nancy's benefit.
Thank you.
We're going. All right. Alrighty. Good evening and welcome to the November 3rd regular meeting of the school committee. Please stand and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, I will run through our agenda this evening and then we will get underway. First, we have recognitions, if there are any. We have public comment, the first opportunity. We then have reports to the school committee from the student council, the liaison reports, the chair report, assistant superintendent's report, and a planning board master plan discussion, as well as the quarterly financial from Mr. Dumas. Under new business, we have the middle school 8th grade trip to New York City, budget transfers, capital projects, school department article warrant 17-024, as well as a vote regarding the future use of the existing center school. And then under old business, we have a capital budget recommendation and school committee policy KHC distribution of materials. Then our second opportunity for public comment are items by consensus and then adjournment. At this time, I will turn it over to you, Carol.
So we'll begin with recognitions. I have not brought any. I'm not sure if anyone on the committee has any.
I think the only recognition that I would bring for the group is that in regards to the elementary school building committee had the groundbreaking at the new site last Friday, October 28th, which was actually largely attended, and all of us were in attendance as well. It was quite the celebratory event, and I just would like to recognize the elementary school building committee for putting on the event and also staying on schedule. And here we are, we're moving forward as all the trucks are evident there. So I definitely would like to recognize that team.
And I wanted to recognize the high school international student night. I didn't make it to the whole thing, but I went to part of it, and it was huge attendance this year. They've instituted the new partner buddy, I can't remember the name of it, buddying system. So they're connecting kids earlier in the year, and the difference that has made, it was really evident. So it was a great night. The kids gave presentations about their countries, and there was food, and all the families were there. It was really nicely done.
Thank you.
Anybody else? All right. Thank you, Dr. Kavanaugh. I think we're all set with recognitions. And we have our first opportunity for public comment, which I don't believe we have anyone here for public comment today. So we can move right on to reports to the school committee. And our first report this evening is from the student council, which I do believe we have representatives. And you can definitely join us over on the left-hand side over here. Feel free to move it.
Okay. Hi, everybody. I'm Ryan, and this is Emily.
Yep.
I guess a few things we talked about last meeting, but we actually carried out. I know we spoke about Spirit Week, but then we actually had the pep rally on Friday last week. I would say it was a great success. It was, I would say, different than last ones, but definitely exciting and suffused the school spirit that we always try. And as I'm sure you know, the homecoming football game was delayed, and they had to play the second half on a Saturday, which was interesting nonetheless. But I think, you know, I went to the second half on Saturday, and there was still a fan section there, so that was great to see the school pride. And even further into Hiller Sports, the field hockey team had their first tournament game yesterday, and they won that. I know I was there, and there was a pretty good fan section for a game at Fruit Street that was held off the school campus, so that was really cool to see. And the volleyball team also, they were co-TVL champions, and they have their first tournament game next week, I believe, on Monday or Tuesday. But basically, the school's pride is still kicking in. It's still going strong, and that's great to see. I think Emily and I both went to international night,
actually. It went really well overall, I think. We were actually able to talk Mandarin with some of the Chinese students, so that was a lot of fun. And then trying like German dishes too. I had apple strudel, and it was very good. Overall, I think it was really nice to welcome the international students. And then on Friday, we had our second Hiller Day, which was really cool. I think people really appreciate it, waking up like later. And we actually had a first period study too, so we had to wait. We could wake up at 8 o'clock, so that was really nice and like a good break overall.
Very nice.
Then this Monday we had our senior Halloween and breakfast, and it was really fun. A lot of people dressed up. I'm pretty sure like everyone in the grade did. And then we had the breakfast in the caf, and the juniors supplied the food, and it was really good. And everyone was there from our grade. And then after that, we went in the gym and had the award ceremony where people were awarded based on categories. Like, we had most engaging, most creative, original, scariest, kind of thing like that. And it was really, really fun. So, yeah. What else do you have?
Also, today we had the Metro West Health Survey that I know we talked about last week, but we took it in our advisory period, and we had about 45 minutes to do it. It was like 150-ish questions. But I know for the most part, students took it really seriously, because I know Dr. McLeod talked about last meeting how they really implement the results of that into our health curriculum and how we teach and how we function as a school. So that's really awesome to see. In terms of new stuff, Miss King, our new AD, she's going to have a winter sports night on November 14th, that's a Monday. She didn't do it for the fall sports, I think, but it's just to welcome the new athletes, the new students, and kick off the new winter season. And then also, we're having a school handball tournament next week, which handball isn't the most popular American sport, but it's very popular in Europe. I know it's extremely popular in France for some reason, but we're having one of those at the school just to have some fun, and yeah, that's what we have for this week.
Great. Thank you. Did anyone have any questions?
That's awesome. Thanks, you guys.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you very much for taking time out of your night. Next on our agenda are any liaison reports.
I have two.
Sure.
The athletic field subcommittee had scheduled a public forum for November 7th, which we have postponed to a date as yet undetermined. So if that's on your calendar, you can remove that. And the charter review committee has a public forum coming up on December 7th. So all of the feedback that has been gathered to date is currently being incorporated. And so we're meeting to recommend our changes based on all of that to the charter, and we'll have a presentation of that on December 7th and look for feedback at that point.
So is that a public forum, or is that a meeting at the Board of Selectmen? Oh, okay.
Public forum.
Oh, got it.
So the Irvine Todaro Property Group had a presentation with the Board of Selectmen on Tuesday. Alton Chen, who's the chair, presented the results of our survey and looked for a little direction from the Board of Selectmen. The one thing the Board of Selectmen did say was that because the bus parking lot did not fare as well in the survey, what he did say is that it was a high priority at town meeting when we voted to purchase the land. It would continue to be high priority, and that they're looking at really a lot of temporary uses for that land, so that down the road, if we wanted to put something more permanent like a school or something else that needs to go there in 10, 15 years or whatever, the space will still be available, that we're not just building to put something there now, but trying to preserve the space and use it in the best way possible we can now. So the committee is going to regroup and figure out what the next steps are from here.
The elementary school building committee met last night. These update meetings with the ESBC take on a completely different character now, because we're talking about things that are getting built, which is fun. Obviously, as everyone saw at the groundbreaking, there's a tremendous amount of work going on right now. They've completed most of the clearing that needs to be done. They're targeting beginning the site preparation for the actual space in which the school is going to be built on the 9th of this month. If you go over to the site over the next couple weeks, you'll actually start to see they're staking out the footprint of the school. So the wing that's closest to EMC has already been staked out, and they'll continue that. They're looking to start the foundation work, I believe it's on the 19th.
Cool.
They are doing some other site prep work, so they're going to put up the protective fencing around the facility. They're continuing to be creative and find ways to save money. So typically when you put up construction fencing, you screen the entire thing to keep dust and debris and everything from going out of the fence. But they recognize that most of the site is actually just surrounded by wooded lot, so they're only going to screen the parts that are next to the abutters. And then probably the big thing that's going on in terms of sound impact is to start to build the fill to level the land. They're going to start rock grinding and continue stump grinding on the site. So they're bringing in two rock crushers. Because we're going to try to use as much of the rock that was pulled out of the ground as possible for the site fill to level the building. So it's great to see that progress. The rock grinding, just as a quick heads up, is probably going to get quite loud. So we will be informing the abutters as well that'll be happening. I just think it's really exciting to just see that. I mean, just the idea that they're going to stake out the footprint of the school, I think is really cool.
That's great.
So. Well, I think what's funny about that to me is that I've seen on Facebook a lot of people posting about the loudness of the toll booths being destroyed if you're on the Mass Pike side of Hopkinton. So I don't think anyone anticipated that. I saw the grinding machines going in this week. Are they already there?
Those are, I think, the stump grinding machines.
Ah, okay.
So, there are two rock crushers that are going to go in, apparently a really, really big one and a littler one. So, in terms of the noise, Compass, as well as the committee, are in very much in constant contact with the neighbors. The Compass indicated, and Colin Antonio indicated last night, that the neighbors have been great to work with. They're not complaining. They say oftentimes you get really hostile people in those abutters, and they haven't been that. So they just want to know what's going on. And I think the current thing they want to know is what's the plan to sort of put back the vegetation barrier that's been taken away when we did the clearing. So Colin Antonio and Werner Larson are actually going to meet with the neighbors in the next couple weeks to talk about that.
You know, at the last meeting, they said one of the abutters has even offered up their driveway for all the construction workers.
Oh, that's
awesome.
Wow.
They're really being very...
Yeah. I think the rock crushing might add a new dynamic to the yoga classes, though.
Hopefully that's a short...
She has yoga right there next door, so hopefully that's a short process.
Yeah.
Might disrupt the the yoga.
Yeah, kind of ruin your zen.
Oh, yeah. Yoga.
Did you have any reports?
No.
Okay. I know that there was a CPAC meeting. Unfortunately, it was the same week that I missed our school committee meeting, and I was not in attendance. I haven't received any reports from... I usually get email feedback after some of those meetings, and I haven't received any, so I'm assuming that it was a relatively low-key meeting, but I will be at the next one, so I will certainly report back to the committee with any news there. Okay, I think that wraps up liaison reports. In terms of the school committee chair report, there hasn't been any communications from the community on any issues, so I have nothing to report there, although I do know that you spoke at the last meeting about question two, and we had received a community member who had asked what our take on that question was, and I know you had a discussion already about it.
I read that email, that one.
Okay, great. So that's the only community input I've really had in the last month since I've been at the meeting. So in addition, the only other piece of information that I wanted to speak to the committee about was, I know that I'm getting conflicting reports on whether or not there was a vote taken on this or not, but basically there was a discussion about, obviously, the horrible accident that happened on Hayden Row, and whether or not traffic calming needed to be brought back up to the Board of Selectmen, and whether we as a committee wanted to send a letter on all of our behalves to the Board of Selectmen urging that there be some action taken in regards to that. And Dr. McLeod had let me know that the committee had agreed that she should draft a letter and bring it back to the committee. Then what she heard from Mr. Kamalo was that they were already forming a subcommittee. And so Dr. McLeod wanted me to ask the committee if we still felt it necessary for the school committee to formally provide our feedback on the issue, being that a subcommittee has been created already, as was discussed at the Board of Selectmen meeting we were all in attendance at on the 25th, or if we think that the formation of the committee is already doing what we had intended to happen with the letter. So I wanted to get everyone's opinion on that, because I don't have a strong opinion one way or the other, although I do see the benefit in the school committee weighing in on the issue, and but I don't think that we had a formal solution that we were proposing. We just wanted them to create, we wanted there to be attention focused on the issue, which there now is, with the subcommittee being formed. So I wanted to get everyone's take to see now, with the fact that there's a subcommittee that's been formed, if we still feel the need to send a formal letter to the Board of Selectmen on this, or if we want to wait until we have a, you know, if we just have to add solutions to the mix, or what we want to do.
And I would say if we are not included in that subcommittee, which, I mean, we haven't received an invitation, so I assume we're not, I think it would be good to
send, I believe Kathy is a member
of
the
subcommittee. Okay. So as long as there's a way for them to understand what you're observing on a regular basis, so that that can be taken into account on the front end, then that's fine. If Kathy's on it, then I don't see the need to send a letter. But if none of us, if there isn't any representative from the school department, then I think we should.
Kathy was formally invited.
Okay.
She will be a part of the meetings. She is an actual member of the committee.
Okay.
So I'm sorry, I forgot to mention that piece. But so from that standpoint, I do feel like the school committee, the school department is represented.
Yep.
So, you know, if anyone else has any other items that they'd want.
So I'm glad that Dr. McLeod is part of the committee, and I know that she'll voice the concerns effectively. I personally still would favor the submittal of a letter, because I think it's also about raising the conscious. I mean, it's about making sure it's raised to the priority of the Board of Selectmen, but it's also about continuing to raise and continue to raise the consciousness of it in the town. I think that we saw when they went for the traffic calming article last time, it wasn't a well-developed or communicated article, but it also wasn't something I felt like was in the consciousness of the town enough to actually drive the results. I mean, we've seen poorly communicated warrant articles pass town meeting effectively because it's something that people are focused on. I keep coming back to the fact that we in that corridor we currently have 3 out of our 5 schools. We're gonna have 4. I think it's again it's a positive step forward that they're having the committee. It's a positive step forward that they're including somebody from the school district. But I still feel like as a committee, I think we do have a responsibility to make it clear that we are really focused on this as a priority for the safety of the students. So I personally would be in favor of still sending the letter. When we can acknowledge that we know that they formed the committee, but it does provide, again, our stance and our level of priority on it.
I don't know what our stance would be, though. Would our stance be do something?
Our stance be I mean, well, so just we haven't really talked about, but really do something and
like we're
and
not
quick.
Solution gathering,
right.
And submitting. We're thank you very much for forming a committee. We feel very strongly.
Something
Kathy
needs to be
had
done.
Actually mentioned at the last meeting that, like, as a neighbor, like an abutter to the traffic, she had a different viewpoint than I do when right. I just drive by, talking about people going around people. I don't know if that would be part of it, but I think it's
there's certainly not. I mean, there's certainly not a reticence to write the letter, and certainly we can present that at the next meeting and get everyone's take on it if we feel that it still would be important. That's what I mean. I'm not opposed to it because I think it puts on record that the school committee is thinking about it. I'm just not sure who sees that record other than the Board of Selectmen. Like, I don't know that it gets the public view. Like, do they read aloud their correspondence in their meetings? So, you know, that's my, you know, I get what you're saying, John, from the public standpoint of it. I mean, unless we're also then just publishing in our agenda materials, then it does get some public availability that way. And maybe it is just a good idea, too, to confirm the fact that, you know, Dr. McLeod is a member of the subcommittee and is representing the school department, and we support the effort, and, you know, please keep us posted if we can assist in any other way, I guess. So certainly I can go back to her and say that, you know, some of the committee members still feel like a letter is necessary, and that's fine. I mean, certainly a letter is not...
Can't hurt.
Yeah, it's not going to hurt.
I mean, I actually, in support of what John said, and apropos of something that we're going to talk about later on tonight, sometimes committees are formed and they really just don't ever go anywhere. And I don't predict that that's going to happen, but I do, this is something that is of great importance to all of us. And so, you know, there really isn't a downside to making that part of our public record. And I don't mean in any way to imply that it isn't important to the Board of Selectmen. I'm sure that it is. I know that it is. But just as a matter of record, I agree. I think that this is critically important already and will only become more so when the new school opens. And, you know, again, sometimes things have a way of taking a long time or not really coming to fruition. And I don't think that's... can't happen here. So
sure. Okay, so we'll let Dr. McLeod know that we're still going to move forward with the letter and bring it back for our meeting on the 17th. I know there may be some attendance issues for one or a couple of us that evening, and so we'll make sure it's in the agenda materials ahead of time so you have a chance to comment if you are unable to attend. But thank you for the opinions on that. I just wanted to get everyone's take on it before a unilateral decision was made whether or not to send the letter, because I wasn't here for the discussion before. So, and that's all I have for the chair report. And we now can move on to Dr. Kavanaugh's report in regards to enrollment.
Okay. So I know that you have in your packet the October 1st enrollment report. And I think that as we look at this, our enrollment has remained pretty steady. The big bump that you see, I think, is at the kindergarten level. What NSDEC predicted was that there would be 204 students arriving in the Hopkinton kindergarten this school year, and that number is up by 20 students. If we take a look at how the numbers play out in grades 1 to 12, they sort of balance each other with arrivals and departures, additional students and fewer students. But overall, for the year, there are 20 additional students. So NSDEC predicted that there would be 3,378 students. In reality, we have 3,398 students in K to 12. And, you know, there are an additional 65 annually in preschool. So we don't have to really look at that number. And I guess that if we had, you know, some kind of concern, perhaps, about those numbers, it's only that the Hopkinton Public Schools are a very desirable place to bring your children and to start them, and it's hard to know if that kindergarten bump is just indicative of that.
So can I just make a request, I guess, as I was reading the master plan, which we're going to talk about in a little bit, and watching the Board of Selectmen meeting from Tuesday, there still is a lot of inaccurate information across the town regarding our enrollments. And so, you know, if we can send them a letter or, to, you know, both to the Planning Board and to the Board of Selectmen, maybe just on an annual basis to let them know, here's what our enrollments are, our October 1st enrollment is, this is the change from last year, this is the difference in what was the NSDEC prediction. I mean, if I wrote down the right number, they were almost 100 off for this year. Did you say 3,378 was their prediction?
No, they're only 20 off for this year.
All right. So
3,378 to 3,398.
Oh, thank you. Okay. Because my heart's skipped a beat. But at any rate, so, you know, it's about to be published in the master plan incorrectly. And, you know, the Board of Selectmen was having some conversation around it at their meeting on Tuesday, which was, you know, they don't have this information. Again, I'm not criticizing them, but I think it would be great if we could share it on a regular basis across the town. Also, Appropriations always wants to know, so I just think it would be great to send a summary letter maybe to all of those departments every year just to let them know.
Madam Chairman, if I could.
Sure.
Just for your information, this information has been submitted to NESDEC, and we should be receiving an updated enrollment report from them sometime in November.
Okay.
And, yeah, we'll definitely
forward that. And it might make sense to wait until that point, but just at some juncture, I do think there is a lot of interest, but they don't all have the up-to-date information, and so I just want to make sure that they have it more accessible to them.
Thank you.
So is the November timeline, though, in time for the planning board meeting on the master plan?
No, that's
the 21st, right?
21st is correct. Right. So we could send it to them.
Yeah.
And just send them that feedback after. I mean, I'm sure there'll be other stuff, too.
We probably could at least include it with any of our other feedback at this time for the master plan. And then once we have the updated report, we could just follow up as well with the planning board and appropriations. I mean, I think that's a great idea, Jean, because of the fact that it was obviously a discussion point for the budget planning.
Mm-hmm.
And certainly would give a little bit of insight as to what the school department is up against in terms of our budget planning. So, you know, I don't have any opposition to that.
And if I could just add one piece to the budget planning. So this year we have 84 students who are identified as English learners. And so that's just a disparate population, a new group of kids that, you know, sort of seems to be coming to Hopkinton. And that doesn't come without, you know, those kinds of unfunded mandates. So we are required to hire additional personnel. This year alone, we're really looking at the addition of almost two FTEs to be able to service our English language learners in the district. And I think that, you know, I know we're going to be looking at the master plan, but I think that as we look at, you know, land use and the ways in which we're developing that land, we have to think about, you know, sort of the additional students and, you know, their needs as they come into the district.
Yeah, no, I think that's an excellent point. I think that's probably why maybe a letter is better than sending them this form, because there's a lot of information that doesn't jump off the page at you, but 84 students can cost different amounts of money, which I think we came up at the budget meeting as well when we were with the Board of Selectmen. So just a little recap of these are the changes, this is the difference in NESDEC, this is what's still predicted, and this is, you know, changes in some of the demographics of our students. I think would just give everybody better context before we get into the part of the budget cycle where everybody's a little more tense.
Yes.
And I think also in that letter, thinking back to the budget meeting and looking at these numbers, I think, providing also even context in the demographic, but also context in what the numbers really mean. Because if you look at it, if I'm NESDEC, right, they were off by 0.5%. Statistically speaking, that's pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
But as Lori, I know as you pointed out, the selectman meeting, 20 kids in kindergarten is class. And the fact that we're up 20 and we're also up 20 in kindergarten means that's also a larger kindergarten class, which means we're likely carrying a larger number than we expected right through the next 13 years. Mm-hmm. So I think that's where we need to make sure that, because I think most people who look at this would say 20 kids, you know, that's not bad. So I think we need to really make sure that that context is in there as well.
Right, so that people don't think the only impact is when you get to 100.
Right.
Which is what came out of that meeting.
Right. Yes. I mean, I think they are still under the impression that we have rapidly declining enrollments just around the corner, and it's just, you know, it just has never proved true.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Great. So then Is that a letter that the committee expects to come back for review before it goes out, or are you comfortable with it going out?
I mean, I would think that would be something that Kathy could to do, but
I mean, certainly I believe she could as well. Yeah. I just want to make sure that no one here is expecting to see it before it goes.
Oh, no, I think if it includes all those highlights.
Great. Okay. Is there anything more? I'm sorry, I didn't want to take over your report.
That is fine. So just a couple of other things. The state has just recently handed down the test number of questions and the test types for the MCAS 2.0. So all of our administrators and our curriculum teacher leaders have access to that information through DESE right now, and we are working to ensure that our curriculum will be significant in terms of preparing our kids for MCAS 2.0 in the spring. Accordingly, we have at both Center and Elmwood, the teachers are working on foundations to fidelity, and just recently with Principal Lauren DeBow and Ann Carver from Elmwood, I was able on a Sunday to attend the Fountas and Pinnell guided reading workshop in Providence, Rhode Island. So I think that that's a program that we're bringing here, and it's going to make a great difference in our reading abilities for all children, including, you know, those who struggle and the, you know, highest performing readers in our district. At the Hopkins School, they are doing a lot of work with that SRSD writing. They have had the consultant Leslie Laud there several days this week, and they are working on looking at student writing and how the scoring works and how to better target writing instruction. At the middle school, I know I attended one of the sessions with Jean. We both attended the very first session of the restorative justice program for eighth graders on, I think, a Monday morning, and it was so impactful. You could have heard a pin drop in that auditorium, and with a group of, you know, 13 and 14 year olds, you would have expected a lot more fidgetiness, but absolutely not. It was really engaging. And Mary Ellen, her courtyard event where they broke out the new mission statement was also very lovely at the middle school, and you know that their new mission is growing an active community of strong minds and kind hearts. At the high school, I have been able to attend the National Honor Society induction, but I think the highlight of the work at the high school recently has been a whole lot of STEM and STEAM. Many of the teachers got to go to the MASQ. Workshops that were held at Gillette, and then just on Monday there was also a STEM and STEAM workshop in Worcester provided by DESE, and lots of our math and science teachers came back and were very much recharged, and we learned that we are one of the few places that does not have one of those great big STEM STEAM kind of community programs. And so Val Achansky and I have had a chance to talk about that, and hopefully we will start getting some footing for that.
Awesome.
So great. That's what's exciting for me.
Great.
Thank you.
So what's interesting is I think I am going to be leading the planning board master plan discussion. and obviously it was provided to all of us. We've had it for a few weeks, and then also it was in our agenda materials. And so certainly want to get feedback, which I can tell already that we have definitely some areas to hopefully correct for planning board in terms of how the school department relates to the master plan and the school district as a whole. So certainly we have some questions here that are posed to us just to get the ball rolling, but if other people have additional questions or, you know, feedback, and I think we also need to come up with how we plan on giving the feedback. Are we planning on sending them a letter or report back to the planning board and having representatives of ours attend the meeting so that we can speak to it, or, you know, we need to figure that out as well. So certainly we can start by what everyone's comments and concerns may be about what was outlined in the plan, and you know, anyone can jump in and kick it off.
Well, as I said, they have outdated enrollment data. So I think, you know, we should correct that for sure. And then, you know, there's a list of projects that the town has undertaken. Buildings that the town has taken, but they only included the schools and not any of the other buildings that the town has built, like the senior center or the police department or the library or the DPW, which have also contributed to the increase in taxes, so I just sort of felt like maybe we could ask that they give the full context and not put all of the burden on the shoulders of the, not that we haven't been very, very well supported in the community. You know, there's a lot in here that I might, I'm trying to just restrain myself to commenting on what affects the school committee, I guess, from this report. So I think that the big thing is to get the school population correct. And then in the other thing that I thought was that they have their transportation goals, and I think in there isn't really a reference to fixing the traffic in front of the schools. And so apropos of our earlier discussion, it might be good to copy them on this letter as well, because traffic is just, you know, there's a lot of focus on the traffic downtown, which is also critical, but 85 going to Milford past all of our schools has really got to be addressed. So I guess those are the biggest ones that jumped out at me.
Well, and what's interesting to me with the traffic calming discussion is that obviously we had a large discussion last year about whether or not to eliminate buses, and a lot of rhetorical feedback that I hear in the community is, you know, well, then why are, you know, the bus fees overall, and why some communities have buses, why some communities don't. And I think that, you know, part of our discussion last year was the safety of the roads for people to walk and small children to walk. And these are, I mean, especially with the new building that's going in, those are the youngest of the children that are going to school. And I don't know anyone that would let their child walk down 85 that was 5 or 6 years old by themselves. So, I think that that's all, you know, that's all wrapped up in it as well.
I know there was reference to an award that the school district won in, like, I forget what year. I didn't know if that made any sense to keep in there.
Well, they referenced, I mean, I feel like we've been on so many lists.
Right, but then they have one specific one. It's like some kind of, it was from, I don't remember what year it said.
2006.
2006.
Kind of, and we've won so many since
then. I didn't know why that one specific one was referenced. It probably happened right when that last, is it a 10-year?
Was written, maybe, yeah.
So but I didn't that, think that, that could that made be refreshed. Sense to stay in there anymore.
Yeah.
But I agree. I think that it had the sidewalk plan in it, but specifically with the traffic calming, I don't know where that goes in, if it goes in multiple places, but beating the drum in multiple places can't be a bad thing.
So with the award list, are we asking them to refresh the award list that we've achieved or remove the old
one? It's only one that's referenced, but then it says has won many award, you know, listed by many places as being a really good district. Specifically, they won an award in 2006 called the something. So that was just kind of weird to have one. It was probably brand new, fresh off the press. So.
Probably. But. Yeah, it's probably better to just refer to multiple as opposed to listing any. Right.
And I don't know if it makes sense, but the for each of the schools, you get the square footage, but you don't get the number of classrooms, which I think tells a very different story.
That's a very good point.
So, for example, if we're looking at the New Center School, and John, you would probably know this, and I may be incorrect, but I think there are 24 classrooms, so that for first and second grade, 12 for each grade level. And if we looked at those numbers from October 1st, that would be about 18.6 children in each one of those classrooms now. So we're really anticipating that those numbers for K and 1 will hold steady at this point, or there would be better than 20 students in every classroom, because there isn't the classroom space, is what I'm saying. So I think the classroom numbers are important.
I think that's a very good point.
Just numbers of classrooms, though, not class size, or both?
Numbers of.
Because none of the other schools had class size.
Yeah. Right, well, as opposed to square footage.
But number of physical classrooms?
Yeah, I think that's a very good point.
Just number of.
Right, number of classrooms, would we be able to do the math readily and determine how many students would fit in a classroom? Because if the population of students gets too high, we may run out of classroom space. right. is what we need to consider.
Ah, I see.
Mm-hmm. I guess at a high level, too, I think there's a lot in here. I don't know who's responsible for the implementation of all of these things, and if there's some responsibility that we're supposed to be shouldering that we're not aware of, or I guess if there's action that is expected from the school department as a result of this. It wasn't clear to me, but it's not impossible that you could find something in there. So I just would like to make sure that there's not a request in there.
Yeah, I agree. We seem to be tangentially mentioned in a couple different places, mm-hmm. but there's nothing specific to the school department.
Action plan
right.
for us.
There just seemed to be a lot of overlap in the sections, and it may be that that's a formula that they have to fill. I really don't know. But yeah, I had a hard time determining if we were responsible for executing something.
Is it at all part of the charter how often this is updated?
No. But I think it's in here that they want to update it every. So.
But that's what was unclear to me reading the document as to what governance does the document really have.
Right.
Yeah, I think you guys were
that
doing the same
that thing. I can help you with because I have learned from being on the charter committee that there's Mass General laws, there's town bylaws, and then there's the charter. And that's the pecking order. I don't know where the master plan fits into that, but I can tell you it does not supersede the charter. So that sort of is behind my question of
who's responsible for implementing.
What are we? Yeah,
where does it go after?
But you're saying
like
for the next 10 years, what has to happen as a result of this anything?
Where's it go?
Yeah. Well, because the thing is, it's not like it's voted at town meeting. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like it's not.
Or maybe it is. It just hasn't come up for revision. Do you think it would be?
Maybe. That's entirely true because I was not here 10 years ago to.
Did it mention it? I was here 10 years ago.
Totally
I don't remember if we voted on it, but
I can't remember
if it mentioned
that.
It in here that it was approved at town meeting or just approved by the planning board.
I don't remember either.
If this is really just a guiding document for the planning board, then they're going to be really busy. But I think it goes beyond that.
There is there was a blank chart, the implementation plan, that it says action plan item timeline, but
plan,
they haven't been filled out, so maybe that's the next.
There's an action plan listed on page 28 as well.
There's action plans at the end
section.
Of every section.
Yeah. Yeah.
At the end of every
yeah.
section, and most of them have like seven or eight
except
or 12
ours.
Goals.
So I guess the
question
is,
well, we have
our
own strategic plan, which would
right, yeah,
be
this
our
is effectively
plan,
the planning right. board strategic plan.
Right.
It's a lot to do.
Oh,
we shouldn't be asking for a to-do list.
Yeah, that's true.
Good point.
What do you want us to do?
Yes.
No? Okay. How can we help?
Okay. Well, I mean, I think we all know that our goal is obviously to make sure the information is correct and that it's presented in a way that's fair and equitable against all the various committees across the town departments across the town rather than just focusing on the school. The school districts. So what I have in notes for this in terms of what we'd like to respond back, and I'm assuming that we're talking about sending a letter and then also having some representation at the meeting. We want to correct the outdated enrollment data. We want to encourage a full list of all the building projects in the town, not just the one school building and other school building projects. We want to raise the issue of the traffic calming on 85 and want to refresh the way the award section is written so that
it's just remove the single reference to an award
so that it's not outdated immediately. Also talked about instead of listing the schools by square foot, list the classroom sizes or the classroom numbers, and then I think the implementation or action from the school committee questions should be left for discussion at the meeting rather than writing.
Yes, yes.
Just my recommendation on that one.
Can I make it just one, Lori, to one thing you said? I think the number of classrooms should be in addition to the square footage, not instead of.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah. The square footage and add the classrooms.
Add the number of classrooms.
Yes, I agree with that.
Got it.
And I think along with the traffic calming, your point about the sidewalks through there too.
The traffic calming and sidewalk is being like the dual issue there.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, I'll talk with Dr. McLeod as to who's drafting this and how it's getting done. We do have one meeting before the planning board, which is the 17th, so I'd be open to bringing that letter back for the committee to review then. And then we'd have it ready to go for that meeting. I don't know from looking at my schedule, I don't know, does anyone know their availability for that planning board meeting?
I'm available.
I think I'm available, and I believe I'm the liaison.
You are?
Well, there you go.
I think I am.
Nice. Look at that. Does that mean you're drafting, too?
No.
Wow, that was quick response.
You already took that one.
No, she took finding out who was going to do it.
I took notes.
You almost took it.
Okay, so I won't have us post a meeting because then we'll send our liaison, and Nancy, you're more than welcome to go as well as moral support.
Enjoyed my
unless more of us want to go, then we certainly will, we can post that we'll be there. But,
I have a charter meeting, so I cannot go.
Okay.
I have a conference at a day in Boston.
Great. So
I have a high level of trust of John's representation, too.
There you go.
There you go.
All right, so we'll bring a letter back to the committee for the November 17th meeting, and you all can give your comments on whether or not we captured everything. And then we'll make sure our fearless liaison is well-equipped for that meeting. Great. Any other comments or discussion about this matter? Or are we good? Okay. Then, Mr. Dumas, you have a quarterly financial report for us.
Would you like to go to Alan? Since he's here. And
I don't know how long is your report going to be.
As long as you want it to be. I can make it quick.
Well, he has another thing later.
Well, we're ahead of schedule right now, Mr. Dumas, so okay. we can move on, because Mr. Keller is next, so I won't keep him too long.
Okay, great. Okay, so we have the first quarter summary, and this is probably the earliest that we've had a first quarter summary. I really cracked the whip on some people this year. Trying to chase down their column changes and stuff like that.
All the years to hit the early.
You're just trying to push everything.
Spoilers well, on the way out the door.
You know, since we're starting the FY18 budget early, I thought it would really make sense for us to get the first quarter for FY17 done earlier as well. So yeah. So as you can see, we're in a comfortable place at this moment in time. The grand total positive variance estimated right now is about $498,000. And that is made up of several positive and negative offsetting variances. Our payroll were a positive $130,000. And a lot of that is because of personnel attrition. We saved $309,000 with all the ins and outs during the summertime. On the negative side, however, there were more column changes than we budgeted. As you may recall, we only budget 30% of the gross value of the column changes, and it came in at 31%. So
that comes in higher.
A few years ago it did, yeah. Then we had savings on pay raises that were embedded into the salary reserve. Some of the people whose pay raises were part of that reserve didn't come back this year, so as a result, you don't give those pay raises out, and so there are some savings there. There were some positions added after the budget process, which you've been made aware of, and all of those positions are listed on the next page. There were some positions that were budgeted and not filled. Those positions are there as well.
Can I ask a question about that?
Sure.
Does that mean that there's no intention to fill them during the year at this point, or is it that I'm sure it's a mixture of us being unsuccessful in finding candidates and then also the fact that we may be reevaluating the need for the position, but do you have any sense of...
Yeah. We are not planning on filling any of the positions that have not been filled.
Okay.
Okay. You'll see later on in the meeting on the budget transfers that we've moved all of the positive and negative payroll variances down to the salary reserve, and the number is going to be exactly the same as the $129,814 positive variance. So that money will stay in the reserve, and it will likely come out through future budget transfers. I know for a fact that we have we're searching for five long-term subs for maternity leaves that will be upcoming, that were people who notified us after this report was completed. So that money is not, that money is now reserved. It's not sitting in a regular salary account number. So,
excuse me, Mr. Dumas, since you brought up long-term subs, the all other variances line item, so is negative 408 due to long-term subs?
There have been some at the beginning of the year.
So is that a measure against quarter to date, or is that a measure against our year's budget?
That's the projected cost at the time that the report was done. It was a combination of things that offset. Like, we have some teachers that are out on maternity leave or taking unpaid leave, and they're being replaced by long-term subs. And the net of the two is that
it's a projection to year end.
Yes, it is.
Okay, all right. Yep, I wasn't sure if we were basically already out of the account, or if we were projecting that by year end we'd be under. Okay, that
all makes of sense. These projections are
they're
for
all
the
projected
entire
to year end. Okay,
yeah,
thank you.
Okay, on the expense side, we have miscellaneous expenses that are in a negative position right now. And that's mostly being because of contracted services for special needs students beyond what was budgeted. Legal at this point, we're trending to be right on budget. Transportation, we have a positive variance of $271,000, and that is almost exclusively because we prepaid our sped transportation at the end of FY16. Sped tuition, it's a combination of things. We prepaid some tuitions, $260,000 of tuitions, but we also had some additional sped out placements for kids who were not budgeted to be out of district. Combinations of move-ins and issues that transpired either during the summer or at the beginning of the school year, certainly after the budget was laid to rest. And utilities at this point, it's really too early to know. Hopefully we'll have another relatively mild winter that will keep us within budget. And on the next page, there's all the pluses and minuses. You've seen, I think, 99% of those presented to you in prior meetings. And then we have the usual breakdown between the state functions and the programs. There's the capital accounts, which you're up to date with every time you meet, and then revolving and grant accounts as well. So I'm happy to report that at the time that this was put together, things are looking up for us this year. It's a good thing that we prepaid the SPED. We prepaid $617,000 worth of SPED last year. If we hadn't done that, the report would look a lot different.
And I must say, I'm so happy to not see the high school amount sitting in the capital accounts.
And as am I.
$74,000 has been returned.
It has. It's been gone since FY17 started.
Awesome.
Yep. So I'm happy to answer any questions that anybody may have. Looks like John has a question.
I do. Mm-hmm. So personnel attrition. I apologize. I had meant to go back and look at a prior year Q1, but I didn't.
Yeah.
Feels higher. Is that directionally higher than? But as I'm saying it out loud, I feel like I asked this question last year, and I feel like it was higher last year too.
I honestly don't remember.
Okay.
Yeah,
it feels like a large number for personnel attrition. I guess what I'm wondering is, and this may be a question that goes to Dr. Kavanaugh, Dr. McLeod, Mrs. Polnick, maybe even my question is: are we experiencing higher turnover?
I That's really hard for me to say. You know, people leave for a variety of purposes. You know, we have a situation that's coming up at the end of this year, or it came up at the end of last year. We had a female teacher whose husband, his job got relocated to the West Coast. Mm-hmm. She finished up the year and joined him. So those things happen.
Individually. I'm just looking at a trend line. Yeah. Like I'm just, and there may not be one there. Just it's a number that jumped out at me. So maybe I can follow up with Kathy on that question. Because I mean, individually there are all kinds of attrition situations. Sometimes turnover is not a bad thing. Yeah. But if we're seeing an increase in turnover, I think it might be worth looking at what the drivers behind that are.
Sure.
We're projected 271,000 to the positive in transportation because we prepaid the SPED.
Yep.
Do we anticipate, are there any potential transportation charges that could eat into that?
Yes. And thank you for asking that question because that brings me to the point of our relationship with Accept. I'm going to Accept tomorrow afternoon for business managers job alike, and one of the topics on the agenda is transportation, in particular next year's transportation. Hopkinton is transporting a lot more kids this year than we were last year.
Through the SPED transportation?
Yes.
Okay.
Framingham is in the same boat, and some of the other districts as well. As a result, Accept has no capacity beyond what they're doing right now to take additional students this year. So we currently have a handful of students that Accept could not accommodate. And so we've had to contract with private carriers to do that. Just recently, we had a homeless situation. We're sharing it with another town. It's $85 a day. Our cost to transport, between, the new home and Hopkinton. It's outside of Accept's area. They don't have the capacity. So topic of conversation tomorrow will be, what are you doing to build capacity?
Well, and that was going to be my next question. Okay.
So, that number, that positive variance could go down
as a
result of that.
As thinking about as we head into budget time, if there is anything that comes to that conversation tomorrow or in the future, it would be great if you could update us.
Yeah, we're actually, at this point in time, we're budgeting a 20% increase in out-of-district, special ed transportation. So that's about another $70,000.
And I think we definitely are interested in that answer from Accept about what their plan is. So speaking of that transportation as we head into budget time, so I'm looking at that $271,000 positive variance, and my question is coming in about regular transportation.
Regular transportation, as you know, as we walked in the door tonight, I told you about the phone call I had today from a parent who's moving from the Woodview Apartments in Legacy Farms to, guess where? The Hopkinton Muse Apartments, December 1st. So that kind of took me by surprise that those apartments were going to be available for rent so quickly. That's an area of town that our buses are really, really jammed. The lake area, I don't have room for any students grade 6 through 12 on those buses. Lumber Street, I can handle probably two or three kids. So if it gets beyond that, I'm not sure what we're going to do. We certainly don't want to inconvenience the families that are currently assigned to buses in that area. But we may have to do something. We're hoping not to this year.
So, okay.
But next year there is a new bus.
That was going to be my straightforward question.
An extra
bus? Another bus in the budget.
Yeah.
Okay. Because I think when you're speaking about Lumber Street in the Lake area, I mean I live on the other side of town, and those 6 to 12 buses are jammed. So I had a feeling that that's what we were looking
at. The good news next year is that because last year we had some fuel adjustment credits that remained in the revolving account, our regular transportation costs, even with a new bus, would go down.
Ooh, I like that.
Which is good.
For that year.
For that year, yep.
Okay, I'm good. Thank you.
I had a question on the middle school auditorium upgrades, because that's also on the capital warrant for this town meeting. This still says ongoing, but that available balance, there's no more work that's going on now that the air conditioning is a separate item. So what happens to this available balance?
Well, I'm going to think back to what we did with the loop road repair a couple of years ago. There had been an earlier appropriation for the loop road, and there were funds remaining in that bucket. Mm-hmm. And so when we went to do the repairs, we went to town meeting to get the money to do the repairs, we only went for the extra, and we combined
so
the two projects.
That. You don't have to give this back, ask for the whole thing, and it's just in all different places.
That's correct.
Okay. All right, thanks.
Any other questions?
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Mr. Dumas. All right, we will now move on to new business. And Mr. Keller, you have a middle school, 8th grade New York City trip to discuss with us. And feel free to take a seat over there as it's a little congested over here.
Welcome.
Thank you.
I haven't seen you in a while.
First time ever. I know. Kind of rocked my world with this whole building.
That was quite a commute for you.
Yeah, that's right. You guys, this is the first time you ever had to go for one of these meetings.
Yeah. Well, thank you. So, as you know, back in July, I made the decision to no longer attend Washington, D.C., and that was really mainly based on three major criteria, and those were the cost. So we were approaching $1,000 last year for 8th graders to attend D.C. We had a record number of students who did not attend. We had 37 students who didn't attend. And ultimately, for me, one of the biggest things that started us looking was a lack of a connection to our curriculum, since we do not study American history in grades 6 through 8. So in July, I communicated that to parents, and I made the commitment that my goal was to keep the cost under $700, looking at an alternative to keep the cost under $700. And seek the input of teachers, students, and parents. So throughout September and October, I've been meeting with those three groups, and we brought forward, or from those meetings, we had crafted essentially three proposals that I then had a task force of teachers, parents, and students offer feedback on, and so we narrowed it down to one, which is what is in front of you. And then once we opted for New York City, with your approval, of course, we then looked at the activities that we felt were most important and connected to our curriculum. And so at this time, as a result of all that work, I shouldn't say all that work, as a result of all that feedback, what I have in front of you is a recommendation. I wasn't able to get exactly to my goal of $700, but it's at $709. And so it is a three-day, two-night trip to New York City from Wednesday, June 7th to Friday, June 9th. And so I am requesting your approval for that trip.
Anybody have any questions?
My eighth grade daughter was very worried that you were canceling the trip altogether because her class always loses out on things. So this is a very welcome sight. And I just had a couple questions.
Yeah.
So you had a number of 37 kids who didn't go last year.
Yes.
What would be what is a typical number that hadn't gone when that got high?
Yeah, so over the past decade, I would say we had anywhere from, we had, I think, as low as 5 students 1 year who did not attend, and as high as, I think, about 15. So that was by far the most that we've ever had not attend.
Okay.
And then, there were a variety of reasons for those students to not attend.
Yeah. Is the pricing at all based on a threshold minimum of students such that if you get 20 kids that say they're not going to go, the price would go up from there?
No, it's not that close. So actually Jump Street, which is the company I'm bringing forward, we looked at a variety of companies, but I think once it gets over 200 is the price is decreased. So unless we had a significant amount of students, 100 students or so,
okay,
that didn't sign up, then we would have to revisit that price. But
okay,
I would be very surprised if that many students did not attend.
Okay. And then just one more around meals.
Yes.
I went back and I was looking at the D.C. trip, but then I remembered I didn't print out that page. But the lunches that are not included with New York, was that the same with
D.C.? That was not. So that is definitely a difference. So for the proposed trip to New York City, students would be responsible for breakfast on the way there, because we would leave the middle school early. And then on the way back from New York, would be responsible for dinner. That was similar to DC. So traveling down there and traveling back, students always had to purchase their own lunch. However, with the New York City trip, students are responsible for lunch on Thursday and Friday.
Yeah, right.
When we get there on Wednesday, they will serve us lunch.
Okay, so it's two lunches.
Yes,
the difference.
Two lunches and then two meals on travel.
Okay.
Two travel meals.
But that was the same.
The travel meals was the same. Okay. Yes. In the past for DC, all meals were included while we were in Washington.
Okay. All right. Thanks.
You're welcome.
Then I saw that Jump Street actually has financial assistance available kids. That's separate from what the middle school can do.
Correct. Yes. So it's similar to what we did last year when we went with Close Up. That did not happen with our previous tour operator, Capital Tours, but Close Up worked with us to help provide additional financial assistance.
So I don't have any questions. I just want to commend the process, because as you know, we hear things from people throughout town, and certainly the decision to cancel the Washington DC field trip, I know how seriously you took that, but there was certainly a lot of conversation about it, and just seeing the outline of, I mean, when I saw the survey feedback, that's what I always kept telling people was, read the survey.
Yeah.
Really kind of had to. But just the process, who was involved, really to arrive at a meaningful trip to create the similar experience for the eighth graders in a more productive way, I think was really thoughtful, and I think was really effective. So I hope the trip is as effective as the process to get there. So
thank you.
I think it was great.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, I think it's really clear how hard you worked with the people, with the parents and the students and the staff. And I thought that the itinerary looked really rich. I love that you're going to a play. Mm-hmm. I always wish that had happened in D.C., mm-hmm. as you may remember that I mentioned.
Plus no dance on this one.
But it's like a dinner cruise, right? Which I think that's great. I think that's a dramatic improvement. So, I think this looks outstanding. I think you did a great job, and I can't wait to hear how it goes.
Thank you.
So, Mr. Keller, the only question I have, and it may actually be more for the committee, but you may be able to answer from your many years of doing these trips, is, so I see we're here today for the final approval, but generally we usually have to do an intent to travel approval first. Are we required to do that in this situation? Or, I mean, I understand you're on a timeline, you're usually already having parent meetings on the trip pretty soon, or mm-hmm. you know, near this time. So I'm just trying to understand from a procedural standpoint if we have another step that we're supposed to do.
I think we did intend to travel, but it was a different trip. Yeah,
we did an intent back.
But you have both in here.
It was the February 4th meeting, because I was looking for it in the.
Yeah, but that was for DC, so that was different. And then I included it in this packet as well, just in.
We could just do two motions. It's in this packet.
Hold on, I'm sorry, because it might just be, oh, yes, required.
I guess we can do two more. I think the purpose of the intent, the purpose of the procedure is just so that we have, more so that we and then the students have enough advance notice of a trip, so.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. I'm not trying to thwart the process at all, or, you know, if it's fine to jump to the final approval, it's fine. I just wanted to be sure that, you know, I've seen it before in the past where we've done the initial, and then, I mean, it's kind of silly in this case, but I just want to be sure that we were being consistent.
When we did the new field trip procedure, I'm not sure we contemplated something like this. But
well, I don't think we did, but I think the point is of the intent to travel, as you said, is so that you can start having conversations and with the kids and getting it on the radar screen, which you already have accomplished by asking their opinion and letting them help you select where you're going to go. So, I mean, we could certainly do two motions and approve both of them tonight, but I think what we intended with the intent to travel has absolutely been accomplished already.
Okay, great.
May I interject one thing, too, just about the itinerary? And I don't know if this is necessary to bring in front of you or not, but one thing that, so you've seen the itinerary, the proposed itinerary. One thing that we're still working through, and I'm meeting with staff tomorrow, is the Metropolitan Museum of Art is included on this itinerary, and we're struggling a little bit with the fact that Natural History Museum is not part of this, and in particular, our science teachers are pushing for that. So I'm scheduling a call with Jump Street to look and see if it's an option to have essentially, it will push the price in the 720, 730 range, and I'd rather not do that. So we're looking at possibly offering students an elective so they could choose between the Met or the Natural History Museum. So I just wanted to make you aware of that possibility as well.
Cool.
Can we maybe, so could I suggest, this is just in my head, maybe we do one motion for both? The motion to approve the intent to travel and final field trip approval. I mean, I think that just covered us and makes
sense. Would you like to make that motion, Mr. Graziano?
I would. I move.
Unless there's any further discussion. No, we're good. All right, go right ahead.
I move that the school committee vote to approve the intent to travel and final overnight travel request for the 8th grade New York City trip from June 7th, 2017 to June 9th, 2017.
Second. Motion by Mr. Graziano, seconded by Mrs. Birchman. All those in favor?
Yes.
And it's unanimous and so carries. Thank you, so Mr. Keller.
Thank you.
Enjoy. We even got you out of here 5 minutes early.
Perfect.
Have a good evening.
Thanks, you as well.
Okay, our next item on the agenda is budget transfers with Mr. Dumas.
Well, I've taken a different approach with this budget transfer. I've broken it down. It's all payroll. And I've broken it down into two categories. The first one is accounts that have excess funds in them for a variety of reasons. Could be the positive attrition, could be column changes not earned, that sort of thing, positions unfilled. So we're moving all that money, and that totals $851,224 to the salary reserve. Okay? So the money's coming out of the budgeted line items that at this point don't need it. It's dropping it into the salary reserve. The second budget transfer is just the opposite. Those are payroll accounts which we project will overdraw their respective budgets due to things like raises, personnel additions, and also includes column changes that beyond what we projected. Those total $837,023. At the end of the day, all of these payroll transfers will result in a salary reserve that totals $129,814. And that's exactly the number that appeared in the quarterly report. So if anybody has any questions about why there are excess funds or why there weren't insufficient funds in these accounts, I'm happy to try to answer those. I have all the information here.
Great. I really like this format. It's so easy to compare. That's the only thing.
Although I'm looking at John, look at it sideways.
I don't know how to make
John's
the thing rotate on my screen.
He's going to have a crick in his neck when he leaves.
Mine's a button.
I stayed up for a little bit.
Can't you just tip your computer on its side?
Oh, I could, no, because then it turns.
Oh, yeah. It's like your iPhone.
You have a sore neck.
Yeah. You're
so,
trying to come up with a question.
No, I have a question. Okay. I'm formulating it. So what is this going to mean for us as we get towards future quarters in the end of the year?
Well,
so go ahead.
If we find the need to hire a long-term sub, and we know, you know, when the person's going to start and when the person's going to end, you know, within reason, we'll come to you for a budget transfer, asking you to take money out of the salary reserve and put it into the appropriate salary line item. We currently have one job opening. It's a 0.6 middle school learning specialist. I have a placeholder in there for that. If the person comes in at more money, I'll have to come to see you for a budget transfer.
So the way you would have done it under last year's method in that case is you would have had then go to potentially like two or three budget line items and pull from...
I would have just squished it all together. You would have had one budget transfer that would look identical to the one it does. We've done this every year, only not broken down into two components.
Yeah, I think, in a positive way, I'm sort of adjusting to the way it looks, because I actually think one of the nice things about it is that this makes it really easy to track when we get towards those additional budgets or end-of-year balances to really clearly see where the money came from. So, I think I like this. I think this is a good... is a good enhancement.
Quick.
Is the rest of the year just going to be filled with you coming up with new and different ways to do things?
Sure, why not? After 39
can't wait
years.
For budget season.
Not 39 years, 30-something years. I think maybe I'll get it right. Not 39.
Just drop the mic on your way out.
Yeah.
So my only comment is I'm not... The budget transfer space was here when I reviewed the agenda, but motion was not yet. And I'm just not sure I'm comfortable with the motion being quite so vague, because it seems that we're doing two different types of transfers here. So I would suggest to the committee that we actually have two different motions, because there's a motion to transfer funds from the salary reserve account, and then there's a motion and make a motion to transfer funds to it. Those are two different transfers that are occurring. I don't know if anyone has an opinion on that. Obviously,
I mean, it's actually a lot of different individual transfers, really.
Mm-hmm. Yes. I mean, I guess maybe the way that I would word it is that, you know, that we move to approve the transfer of funds to the salary reserve as outlined in the agenda materials, and then do the same with from. That would be my only, because obviously, yes, I do not want to run through all of those account numbers. I just think that because there's going to and from, I don't know, from my old checkbook days, it seems like we should be keeping them separate.
I would agree. I think it is two separate and distinct actions, and I think should be recorded that way. I think it makes it look cleaner from the actions that we're taking.
So. I mean, Mr. Dumas, you certainly have outlined exactly what the transfers are, and so I have no qualms about that. I just think that I would prefer the motions be done like that. And also, I'm open to any other questions or discussion that anyone might have on the transfers themselves. All right. It seems that we're silent. So... at this time, then, I would seek a motion to approve the transfer of funds to the salary reserve from payroll accounts as outlined in the agenda materials.
So moved.
You might want to just put the number in if you're going to do that.
What number?
It'll be $851,224.
Yeah. Great. Let me start that over, Nancy.
Mm-hmm.
I would seek a motion to transfer funds to the salary reserve from the payroll accounts in the amount of $851,224.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Cavanaugh, seconded by Mr. Graziano. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, and it's unanimous. It carries. And I would seek a second motion to transfer funds from the salary reserve to payroll accounts in the amount of $829,837. Seek a motion to transfer funds from the salary reserve to payroll accounts in the amount of $837,023.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Cavanaugh, seconded by Mr. Graziano. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. And it's unanimous and so carries. Okay. Thank you. Our next item, go far, Mr. Dumas.
No, I'm hanging in.
The Capital Project School Department Article Warrant 17-01 024 in the amount of $121,068.85.
Okay, there are three invoices, one from DCM Controls for the school safety and security project, $119,266. There's an invoice from Custom Alarm for the same project for $202.85. And then we have an invoice from Mac Ritchie Engineering for engineering services related to the middle school auditorium upgrades, which is Article 24 of the May 2016 town meeting for $1,600. And we recommend that these items be approved for payment.
Any questions or discussion from the committee? All right. At this time, I would seek a motion to approve the payment of warrant article number 17-24 in the amount of $121,068.85 to the vendors as outlined in the agenda materials.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Cavanaugh, seconded by Mr. Graziano. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes. And it's unanimous and so carries. All right. Our next item. I know, Mr. Dumas, we're going to bring you back in a second.
Don't worry about it.
Under new business is discussion of regarding the vote, well, of discussion and vote regarding the future use of the existing center school. Mr. Camallo had reached out to Dr. McLeod about the fact that, and I'm not entirely sure, forgive me for not knowing if it's under in accordance with the charter or if it's in accordance with bylaws or mass general law, but the school committee currently presides and reigns over the use of that building, and while we're occupying the building and using it as a school, the Board of Selectmen cannot make any decisions about an alternate use for the school. So the town manager has requested that the school committee formally vote to approve the fact that the Board of Selectmen can start exploring alternate uses for Center School once it no longer is a school building or in use for a school building, and we turn it over to the town. Mm-hmm. Obviously, all of us know that the town itself has been asking lots of questions, what's going to happen with Center School, and this is steps towards putting together some options for the town to consider and the Board of Selectmen as well. So if anyone has any questions on why we need to vote on this, that is the reasoning that we were provided.
So I'm going to just say I strenuously disagree with the premise that was presented. However, I strongly support them moving forward in this direction. So if they need us to vote to request that formally again, then I think that's a good idea. But, you know, formally and informally for the last 5.5 years, this is a request that's been made. They commissioned a group already. So, you know, I don't understand. Whatever. But the point is, it's long overdue, and I think it's clearly important to the community. It's clearly important to us. We've included it in survey, you know, so whatever it takes, that's great.
Can I just ask a question about that? Is it your feeling that we've already given this approval, and so they don't need it again? Or is it that...
I feel like the impression is that we've somehow slowed this process
down.
Oh,
I see what you're saying.
I think we did vote and made a formal request in the end of 2010. There was a town building use study committee commissioned in 2011 that met two or three times and just fizzled, and you know, and a lot has happened in between those times, but we have requested, the ESBC has requested, this conversation has happened many times, formally and informally over the years, and so I absolutely wholeheartedly support this request. I just am surprised that somehow this is now a necessary step that we've missed. That's all. And I'm just a little frustrated.
I want to be clear that it was not stated to me or to Dr. McLeod that we have, as a committee, missed anything or delayed anything. It was more stated that...
Well, that was the impression at the their meeting in the paper.
Oh.
Which is why.
I agree with you. This is the first that we have been requested to do this motion.
Right.
And in fact, it was not even requested in time for our prior meeting to have done it, because obviously we added agenda items to the meeting, special meeting we had with the Board of Selectmen. Otherwise, we could have taken care of it that night. Mm-hmm. So I will assure you that seeing the request myself, it was just before we posted all the agenda materials.
Yeah, no, and again.
So for the public's knowledge, that's when we were requested of this. So we've not been holding on to this for months and months and months.
I agree
that we're all happy to provide this permission and get the ball rolling.
Let's do that.
But thank you for adding that, because I didn't pick up on that as well.
So. I would like to request that a member of the school committee be included in a committee. I don't know if that's something we need to put in the motion. But given that one of the uses that has been discussed for 6 years, if not more, is potentially locating the school administration offices there, we also potentially could have a great use of it for our 18 to 22 programming. There are a lot of uses still related to the schools, but not exclusively in the domain of the school. Not that the entire building would need to be dedicated. So I would hope that a member of the school committee would be included in the committee. But.
Okay, I will take a note on that and get back to Mr. Kamala with that request.
So the one request I have, I agree with Ms. Birchman. I want to move forward with this. The entire request seems superfluous. They're not making a decision. They can form a committee without us. But it says, examination of potential future uses for center school property that may be feasible when the school committee determines that the property is no longer needed or required. If we could change when to if.
That's good. Alrighty.
Any other comments? All right, I would seek a motion. Well, this is not drafted in a way that makes that easy.
It's did the school committee request the Board of Selectmen? Didn't they ask us?
They asked us to ask them.
So, yeah.
It's like high school.
I think the way that we might want to put this is that a motion to approve that school committee authorizes the Board of Selectmen to undertake an examination. That's really what it is. Yeah. It's an authorization.
I like that word.
Any objection to that change? Okay, John, can I just double check with you? You wanted the when out of there, but if you put an if there, that doesn't make a lot of sense to me, reading it aloud.
Why not?
Read it. It sounds weird.
An examination of potential future uses for the center school property that may be feasible if, upon the closure of the school committee determines that the property is no longer needed or required.
Maybe it's just the comma needs to be gone. Yeah. That's the problem for me, was the comma. Okay.
Didn't comment on the comma.
All right. At this time, I would seek a motion that the school committee authorizes the Board of Selectmen to undertake an examination of potential future uses for the center school property that may be feasible if, upon the closure of the school committee determines that the property is no longer needed or required for educational purposes.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Graziano, seconded by Mrs. Cavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes. Any opposed? Okay, it's unanimous and so carries. Now under old business, capital budget recommendation from Mr. Dumas, because Mr. Ghosh is unable to join us this evening.
I guess I'm on the hot seat. Dr. McLeod, I don't have a show. So,
Dr. Kavanaugh's sitting there ready
but
to
she
help.
She had nothing to do with this, so I can't blame her. So we amended the 10-year plan that we brought to you to reflect the conversations that we had a couple weeks ago. Specifically, we've reordered the items to show all the FY18 requests together. Kathy directed us to remove the project related to the Administrative Office Center School reuse, and then we've prioritized the FY18 projects. Regarding the committee's request for town debt information, I'm assuming that you've read this, but just to bring you up to date, we did get some information from the town, and I had conversation meetings with Chris Sandini and the treasurer, Mike Connolly, and they pointed out that at this point, the town is going to be doing a major borrowing in excess of $25 million in the next couple of weeks, and they were reluctant to project what those what that debt service would look like. So the figure is going to be available by the end of the month. The major items have been the school, the library, and the DPW. Chris, in particular, appreciates the fact that the school committee wants to weigh the capital requests within the framework of the town's overall debt picture. The picture is just not clear enough right now. So I'm suggesting that the committee judge the merits of each request and then forward whichever items you feel are appropriate to the CIC. And then once the debt picture becomes clearer, you can make whatever adjustments that you would like to make. So with all of that in mind, we have the 10-year plan, and the yellow ones are the ones that I think you have yellow highlighted, right? Mm-hmm. Those are the ones that we're asking to go forward for in FY18. The number one priority is the Elmwood receiving door. System-wide security upgrades, number two. Air conditioning at the middle school. Buildings and grounds equipment. That $30,000 is for a mower, some sanders, and a golf cart. System-wide technology upgrades. $25,000 to get the ball rolling on the buildings and grounds storage facility. Money to get the ball rolling on the Elmwood major building renovation. The next is get the ball rolling again. This is to do engineering work, study work, to determine what is necessary and what it's going to cost in the future for the Hayden Row campus paving, formerly known as the Loop Road. The next one is Hopkins HVAC assessment and upgrades, and then the lowest priority on the list was the new turf field with lights. And at this point, we have no idea, you know, what the timing is on that. I don't know what the cost is. So it's there. If you'd like, we can get it, you know, in the CIC and bring them information later. Clearly, if the school committee doesn't want us to submit these as priorities, if you want to weigh them all as equal priorities, which is what you did last year, you can do that as well. On the forms we fill out, they do ask the priority number, and last year I just said NA, or not prioritized, you know, something like that. So I put all of that out for your consideration.
So the only thing I thought that we had said was that we were going to call it like the Elmwood School Project instead of the major building renovation, because that makes it sound like we've already gone that direction.
Okay. My mistake then. Okay.
And personally, I'm all for a prioritized order. That's just okay. a personal opinion.
So that'll be Elmwood School Project.
Okay. I thought that's what we had decided.
I think it was Solution, didn't we say?
Elmwood
it was the
School
same as the
Solution.
Center. We mirrored the Center
Solution.
Okay. Yeah, Elmwood School Solution.
So then on number seven, we would just have to make sure it's just submission to MSBA for a solution to the Elmwood School.
Okay.
So I appreciate it. So first of all, again, yet another, I think, example that we seem to be having some much better dialogue with the town at this stage of the game about the financial picture. So I completely appreciate Mr. Sandini's reluctance to give more of a picture given the size borrowing that they're about to engage in. My personal feeling is I think as we sort of indicated last meeting that I would like to personally move all 10 of these forward to CIC. I'm not personally in favor of prioritizing them because of a couple of things. One, without knowing either A, that debt picture, or B, what our overall operating budget ask is going to be, it's difficult to know. And it's not, as we prioritize them, they're not equal in cost. So we might, you know, if we determine we have an appetite for how much we want to put forward in debt, we might not go sort of 1 through 5.
Sure.
And additionally, I think the other thing is I don't want to drive we've had experiences in the past where we have sent prioritized lists in and the assumption has been, well, we'll give you 80 or 10. And we didn't really have the opportunity to determine how we actually want to do that. So that's sort of my concern. So, for instance, like new turf field with lights is 10 because it's not, I would imagine, I'm projecting here, that it's not sort of operationally critical to the buildings like security, et cetera, are. And we also don't have a clear enough picture. Ms. Birchman and I are on that committee that's studying that right now. So I'd hate to have that sort of get chopped off because we don't have enough information when we're actually really trying to move ahead with a proposal for next town meeting. So I think there's prioritization work to be done through the budget process, but I personally would prefer not to submit it as a prioritized list right now.
I agree. I'm not ready to prioritize, which is not to say that at some point I won't be, but I think it's too early and you know, there just is not enough context, which is essentially the same point that you made. So, nice job. And I'm just going to apologize. Can you refresh my memory why we took the administrative office space off?
I think you need to have a conversation with Kathy about that.
Okay. I don't remember that. And
I think it can't be an FY18 project.
It was not an FY18 project.
Oh. Yeah, but it's not on here, period, though.
Okay. Oh, yeah, good point.
Do we have to send this over?
We do.
We're voting on this tonight to send it? Is that what we're doing?
We need to submit something on Monday.
On Monday. Okay, can we just pencil that in? Because that's what I just...
Pencil which? The administrative?
The administrative. I just put a big stake in the ground on the center school building in that regard. Didn't we used to have the White House on here, and we don't now?
I said that was
That was not here 2 weeks ago.
It wasn't.
It was not on the list 2 weeks ago.
But would that be wrapped up in the administrative solution?
No, because the White House is.
I kind of think we'd want to bring.
The White House project. Was looked at to be, part of the admin office solution, but also to convert that into a life skills program.
Right.
And that life skills program vision was the vision of the former director of student services.
Mm-hmm.
Anything more than that, I think you need to talk to Kathy about.
So here, I obviously wasn't part of the conversation 2 weeks ago, but refreshing my memory, is this our only, do we not have an opportunity to make an update to this statement to the CIC, or is this it?
It's so early.
This is the beginning.
Oh, yeah.
We definitely do.
We do. The only reason I raise it, and I didn't mean to imply that I want to put it in FY18, because I absolutely do not, but the only reason that I raise it is that there's been so much conversation around going back and refreshing CAMP and looking at CAMP, and I don't want, which I believe the administrative office building space would be on CAMP because it's been on this spreadsheet for years. I just don't want, if we submit it without it, I don't want that to be implied that, you know, it's forever being removed, because if that comparison is starting, you know, there are some things on here that are definitely not in CAMP, and then there's a lot that is, but so I just want to preserve it. We can certainly always remove it later.
So you want to add back the White House just as a placeholder?
Well, I think administrative, maybe to use the same language, administrative office space solution. covers all of those bases.
I believe a few years ago, it was around the time of camp, we did fold the White House into that, because as I recall, Mr. Dumas, you might recall, the White House drove like a solid hour of discussion at one of those camp meetings, and it really wasn't very much money.
Right.
So we realized it wasn't solving one. So.
And the interesting part about the White House is that that's not school property. It's unclear as to whose property that is.
Well, that's interesting. Who mows the lawn?
Yes.
Who pays taxes on it?
Nobody. It's town property.
It's town. Oh, okay. It's town property, but we don't know if it's school property or...
I've heard...
Who pays the heat?
Oh, we do.
Well, there you go.
I've heard that it belongs to...
There's no heat in that building.
Perhaps the HAA, which is odd.
Really?
I don't know how we ended up with it.
Oh. Can I... A couple more notes on this. One, when we talked about the Elmwood School solution, if we could also then update the footnote for number 7.
Yep.
Which also says for renovation.
Yep.
In the course of the feasibility study meetings that we had around the turf fields, both engineering companies brought up the fact that the track was, This kind of jogged my memory. I should have asked this earlier. I apologize, but so first of all, the track that we did the resurfacing, it has a usable life of around 5 years on the surface. They said that's the usual replacement cycle. I know we went a lot longer on the last surface, but they also said that we're approaching the point in time where the entire track would have to be redone. So we'd have to regrind the asphalt base below, redo the entire thing. So if that's the case, should we be carrying that on the capital plan somewhere? Because I think they, both Warner Larson and Gail estimated that that would be somewhere in the neighborhood of $1 million. I think they might have said 900,000.
If the turf field goes forward with, so could that potentially be part of the project?
It could. So if we did an option where we disturbed the track,
right,
it would be, but we might not. So like, so if we do, we could just sort of sweep it up and then take it off of the administrative solution. But I just think if we've got that kind of potential replacement number hanging out there, potentially over the next 5 years, we should have that included somewhere.
So now we're up to 16 items on our list.
And how much money do you want me to put in there? $1 million?
Mm-hmm.
That's what they said, right?
Yeah.
They both said $1 million, yeah.
And high school track replacement?
I don't know what you call it. Yeah. I mean, it's because it's not resurfacing. It's more than resurfacing. They're talking about,
Re-engineering.
Rehab.
I think it is replacement. I think it is replacement. Yeah. They're basically taking everything out of it. And
It's just never occurred to me that that would only last 5 years.
Yeah, I thought that was a...
Yeah, that was...
A much longer.
They both said it, and they both said it very matter-of-factly, that this is a replacement cycle for a track surface.
Wow. How much was that?
$250,000.
Yeah. Right. And I don't believe that was highlighted at the time.
Yeah. No.
I think that came to
a surprise.
People thought
they were signing up for the next 20 years.
Right.
Right. That came as a surprise to those of us in the room who were part of that process.
Thanks.
Okay.
So I mean, it might even be worth validating with either. I mean,
I can call Gail.
Yeah, or call
I mean,
David
they engineered
Warner.
It for
yeah,
me.
See
so,
what, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Any other comments? So we have quite a few revisions. Are you clear on the revisions?
I am absolutely clear.
And are we all in agreement of not prioritizing?
Yes.
I know, Kelly.
I'll go with the majority. That's fine.
I mean, I feel like if we have an opportunity to update, we have an opportunity at that point to prioritize. But we haven't even seen the operating budget yet, to have a clear picture. I'm with you on the fact that I like to be able to prioritize, but I think we're a little early in that.
Well, the ask from 2 weeks ago was that the administration come back with need-based priority. So that was my ask, and that's what I'm guessing this was based on, was that
Elmwood Receiving Door was further down the list, yeah. after this discussion, that's the thing that's needed the most. Like, door will not survive, needed as number one. So that's why I argued, or argued, that's too strong of a word, that's why I would be in favor of this priority order. I hear what you guys are saying from prior budget cycles, but this is a need-based priority, not a, like, blind to the budget impact. Mm-hmm. It's what the school district needs the most. So I do think that there is validity in this priority order, but if you've been burned and you don't
prefer I mean, I think for that one, I agree with you, but then I think it gets muddier, and I almost think we sort of have, you know, category A, category B, category C, maybe, and that's where I think, that's why I don't want to commit to this exact, I don't think we went to that level of detail when we put them on this sheet, so that's all. I think, and, you know, there's still information evolving around the athletic fields and whatnot. So, I mean, I don't dispute what you're saying about the Elmwood Receiving Door, but I think once you get a little bit deeper into that list, then there's some more conversation, I think, that needs to happen. That's all.
Okay. I'll go with whatever you guys... I mean, I've said why.
Okay. So is there any other discussion for the... Okay. So... Right. So I think then at this time we're ready to seek a motion to approve the fiscal year 18 capital improvement request as amended per our discussion this evening.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Graziano, seconded by Mrs. Kavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. And it's in the
carries. Thank you.
I believe you're all set, Mr. Dumas.
He needs the...
We need the warrants. I might as well stick around.
Okay. Yeah. The last item under old business is school committee policy KHC distribution of materials. This may seem exceedingly familiar based on recent meetings, but I will let Nancy introduce the topic, and then I actually have an email from Dr. McLeod to read to the group to give her opinion on the matter.
So this came back, as you'll remember, we did approve this 2 weeks ago, is that correct? And it came back because as they were going to look to post this, it became apparent that in the policy that we approved, the KHC, it calls for an application for the distribution of materials on district grounds. It was there in the policy that preceded this that was already in place, but in practice there actually never has been an application. That's not the procedure that's been used. Mm-hmm. So I was asked initially to draft an application, which you'll see in the packet I did do. But then the other piece was that the town clerk expressed some concern over the application process itself in a couple of different ways. One is that because state election laws trump school committee policy for obvious reasons, there are certain things that couldn't be enforced if depending on how we constructed things for where people could put their signs, that if Dr. McLeod is approving applications or declining to approve applications, we are infringing on what could be construed as their right to put signs up outside the polling places. It also, I spoke with him myself just to try to get a clearer sense of what the actual other concerns might be, and one is that it might be suppressing the candidates, their ability to have their signs posted, it's more cumbersome from them. And if the superintendent were to decline one of them, it could become an issue. So in talking with Dr. McLeod, a second suggestion, other than doing the application itself, which was what I was originally asked to do, was to amend the policy to take out the application, references to the application, and instead keep just the part in the policy that calls for the material, if the materials distributed, posted, or carried must be done so outside the school building, only within designated areas as approved by the superintendent, so that it gets at the part of the policy that we were most concerned with without adding a cumbersome application process.
But does it still say they need to obtain written permission?
No, that part should be stricken. The written, anything that says written.
Obtain approval of the superintendent.
Yes, the written should be taken out. The first sentence, any organization or person desiring to distribute written or other materials on district property or carry or post signs on district property must obtain approval of the superintendent or his or her designee.
Yeah, my copy says written is struck.
Okay.
What is in the...
I think there's two.
There's three copies.
There's three. There's one where it's complete. The paragraph is completely struck. There's one where written is not struck. There's one where written is struck.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Okay, so what the note that Kathy has on here is not to strike that part.
Not to strike the
part that I just read that starts, any organization or person desiring to distribute written or other materials. This came out of, I think, the revised packet.
So basically we're keeping the first sentence of the second
paragraph, striking written.
And the last sentence, right. The second sentence of the third paragraph.
This one at all.
So,
I'm sorry.
We're keeping this
before we get discussing, let me just read what Dr. McLeod had to say,
please,
and then we can certainly all provide feedback. I just want to make sure that I get what she wanted us to hear on the record. But so it says the current procedures for seeking approval, and this is an email from Dr. McLeod that I received on October 29th. The current procedures for seeking approval through the superintendent's office for the distribution of materials is working well. I am concerned that requiring a written application will create unnecessary changes to a process that has been in place for many years. In addition, we have been advised that voters are not required to have their materials approved through my office per state election laws. I am uncertain what basis I would use to withhold such approval. Rather, I believe what we should be focusing on, Lord, is the part of the policy that speaks to designated areas on school grounds. Thus, I am attaching an amended policy with my comments, and I'm not certain which amended policy. She did attach an amended policy, but I want to make sure I can tell you which one of the agenda materials ones it is, because Megan didn't include it. One second. So, when I printed out the packet, it was the first one that came out, which is actually the one we're just discussing, where the first sentence of the third paragraph, any organization, is included, and the term written is crossed out, and then the rest of that paragraph is deleted. So that's what the one that Dr. McLeod recommends.
Does it have this too?
The first sentence of the next paragraph is deleted, where it says applications approved for, that portion of the sentence is deleted up to the word or, and then instead the whole sentence would read, the carrying or posting of signs must be distributed, carried, or posted outside the school building only within designated areas as approved by the superintendent. So I just want to make sure we're all looking at the same thing.
And I think that actually is clearer in cleaner English, where leaving that first sentence in that paragraph in is a little bit redundant to what the sentence she added in,
mm-hmm.
in the paragraph above that. So if you look
I'm good on the policy. So my question is this. So when we talked about this, whether it was a couple weeks ago or whenever the last meeting, we all sort of reacted with some amount of surprise, having most of us held signs on school property, that we were unaware that there was any right. procedure or requirement. So in her email, Dr. McLeod makes reference that the current procedure, approval procedure, is working properly or working effectively. What is it?
So I actually had asked her that
okay.
today. The procedure, if people email essentially and say they would like to distribute or they would like to, and she said they just actually declined one that was a for-profit type of thing that they wanted to distribute materials within the school. Another example of people looking to distribute would be if they wanted to send, she said, something to do with a fundraiser, that it was a written material and they wanted to pass out flyers, and they had gone back to say that an electronic version would be better.
Yep.
It's not an application in the same way that the something like this is, or like what we do for the banners would be, but there is correspondence with her. She has not corresponded with candidates with the posting of signs.
My personal sort of feeling when we're revisiting this is application or no application is somewhat less relevant to me. It's making sure we have the controls in place for, I completely understand the town clerk's perspective that obviously state election law trumps any policy we're going to put in place, and I would certainly never envision that the school district would approve or not approve certain candidates from holding their signs, even if they could. But I guess the way I was looking at this was an opportunity for this district office to control the appropriateness of what's being held. And because it says in here in the policy, other materials or the carrying of posting of signs which are likely to disrupt the work and discipline of the school, and it says include but not limited to political statements. And so it's difficult for me to square how vote for someone is not a political statement that would be covered under this.
I think that the vote for would be different than, for example, a pamphlet outlining specifics of candidates, something that might be less.
So, but
more information, kind of.
Right. I guess what I'm coming back to is, but candidates have never traditionally gone through the office to seek approval. So, if you know, I'm hypothetically out there holding a sign that says "Vote for John Graziano," that's one thing. But if I have, you know, three or four different signs that have different messages, that we're not there's that's the part that doesn't, that seems to exist outside this process, and I get why it exists outside this process from an election law perspective, but do we really want to give up at least the control of ensuring that we are not, that candidates aren't making, you know, distributing other materials?
I think that I think we're all struggling with a little bit is that the holding of the signs is something that is, we don't really have the interest in or the authority to take care of that, to regulate that, but there are other circumstances that we may or may not be able to foresee where we would want some more control.
So I guess for me, wouldn't the entire issue be rectified by stating that, starting the entire policy off with, like, we're not in conflict with mass general law or state election laws. The school committee, you know, has created the following policy in regards to the distribution of materials. You then still have the ability to deal with political statements where if you have someone providing their views on abortion, having some discretion there, where state election law isn't going to have any purview on that. Freedom of speech and those types of things may, and that may become a different issue, but like state election law is not going to play a part in that. And I think that is where we're getting at with the political statement language versus candidate signs. But our whole goal here is we want to have some say in the area that this occurs and the types of materials that are available to students specifically. Mm-hmm. But we want to be in compliance with the laws. Mm-hmm. So I think the catch-all, if we put that language in there, you know, you're basically saying, well, as long as we're not in conflict with those laws, this is what we're going to do.
So I'd be okay with that. I mean, again, my questions are really driven at the fact that I think that it's difficult
for it doesn't have clarity for the situation that we're that specific situation that we're talking about, right? It's difficult right. to actually discern. So I think that statement would probably cover that. I mean, you know, if you are a candidate and you read this policy, I don't think you're sure what to do.
Right. I mean, I agree with Laura. The reason this keeps coming back to us is all around the elections,
yeah.
right? So I think putting acknowledging that right up front in the policy it does clarify that, adding it into the
references.
Policy or legal reference, you know, adding the relevant election laws in there also help clarify that. And then, but then beyond that, we do want to maintain our ability to prevent. I mean, I see this as a lot about leafleting cars and things like that, not related to specifically an election, but that we really do want to regulate so that we're careful about what is being thrown on the ground and what our kids right. are being exposed to and whatnot. So, but I think you hit the nail on the head.
Mm-hmm. All right. So,
I was just going to add to that. I think that Dr. McLeod's position is that the how it works now, that they, in what it does say in here, even if we strike the application out, is that they still need the approval, and
right.
that for her office, it works the way it is, and she doesn't want to change it.
That's great.
That's to add, she doesn't want the application added.
Right. Okay. So, Nancy, why don't you and I take a second look at this
yes.
and add that type of language in the references? We'll bring it back to the committee for the next meeting. Mm-hmm. I know that Dr. McLeod had concerns over the fact that the election is obviously next Tuesday. There has been no inquiries to date with her office looking for the application that's referenced or, you know, any type of request of that nature. Like we all said, we were not intending to change the historical holding of signs out in the designated areas, which by and large our school resource officer enforces, as well as most candidates follow those rules mm-hmm. due to historical knowledge as well. So I don't think we have as pressing a concern as it may seem because of the election, especially because there's no school that
right.
day.
Right.
So the students
it's
aren't even there.
It's not interfering with the school.
So I think it makes sense for us to take it back, do some further drafting, clarify, and also just because there's three different versions in here, we'll repost it to the listserv with those changes and then come back to the committee and get everyone's take on it. And if we're comfortable at that point and Dr. McLeod will be back for that meeting, then we can put it to bed.
Perfect.
Okay.
Can I just ask one
sure.
question while you guys meet? If I was a candidate looking to run for something and I wanted to hold signs, I would not think that I should look at the distribution of materials policy, because I'm not handing anything out. So maybe something in the naming of the policy that could make it more clear that it also is covering. I mean, I think somewhere along the line, the holding of signs got added to this policy when it was really about leaflets, and the name doesn't reflect that. So if we're going to point somebody and say, oh, you're going to hold signs, go look up our policy. Which policy? The distribution of materials policy. They're like, I'm not distributing material, you know, but there's stuff in there about holding signs too.
No,
you know,
I think
so. Maybe something in the
what John just said about distribution and/or display of materials may be the way to combat
yeah.
that. And
just
where addition,
materials
I mean,
is kinda
obviously we're gonna be weird providing it back to the town clerk again, and they'll have it for.
And to be clear, he is opposed to an application process of any sort for that, because he thinks it's, even if it's in compliance with Mass General laws, he thinks it's suppressing candidates' right to hold their signs.
The 7-day thing, or just
the
application
process in general?
Okay,
that was his.
To be clear, I would personally support if we could have a policy that eliminated the holding of signs at the middle school. But I guess
that would be lovely, wouldn't it?
That is not before us today, Mr. Graziano.
I'm just saying it came up. Just getting it on the record.
All right. So we are going to not take any action today. We will bring back a revised version for the committee to consider at the next meeting, and I will make sure that Dr. McLeod, as well, I'm sure Dr. Kavanaugh will, that we'll add it to that agenda as we're in the process of creating that agenda right now. And Nancy, you and I can chat.
Definitely.
That would be great. And thank you as well for all the work that you did in short notice on this, because I greatly appreciate it. As we were trying to get something together for this meeting, and I appreciate it. It was last minute. Okay, so we will move on to our next opportunity for public comment, which we have no one from the public here, so we can move on to items by consensus. Before we vote on this, you all were provided a revised version of the October 6th minutes. And Ms. Kavanaugh, can you explain what the clerical error was that made the need for that to be redistributed?
So for the October 6th minutes, for some reason, only three pages uploaded, and there are six.
Oh, okay.
That was the issue with the October 6th.
All right.
There also, in the revised packet, was the date is escaping. It's
October
the 25th.
It was supposed to be the 25th. It was listed as the 26th. Right. And obviously, in a consent motion, I would change that date to the 25th from the 26th. But I wanted to make sure that none of the committee members had concerns about whether or not we need to pull these out because they either didn't have an opportunity to review because of the full limit minutes were in there, or if anyone is still comfortable with it being part of the consent agenda. So I can give you a couple minutes, but I just want to end, you know, obviously the discussion is available. I just wanted to give the opportunity.
Well, if it's a consent thing and I wasn't there for your motions, but I was there for the...
Well, you reviewing the minutes, we can pull that one out if you want to abstain from those particular minutes. Certainly.
Okay. Let's do that just because...
Okay.
I can only speak to part of what happened in this.
In the October 6th minutes, there's just one typo regarding the date of the athletic field subcommittee meeting, which should be October 17th instead of 18th.
On the third
it's
page?
On the top of page 3, yeah.
All right. Why don't I do this? I'll pull both of the minutes out. And then we'll vote a consent agenda on the warrants, and then we'll vote separately the minutes. Does that sound like a plan?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. So at this time, I would seek a motion to approve the items by consensus letters A and B as outlined below in the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Graziano, seconded by Mrs. Kavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
And it's unanimous and so carries. And as for the consent items that we're pulling out separately, the October 6th minutes, as Mrs. Birchman just notified us that on page 3, the date of October 18th will change to October 17th. Is there any other comments or issues in regards to these minutes? All right. So at this time, I would seek a motion to approve the minutes of the regular school committee meeting of October 6, 2016, as amended.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mr. Graziano. All those in favor?
Yes,
and it's unanimous and so carries. And as for the minutes of October 25th, which in your agenda is listed as October 26th, does anyone have any additional comments or changes that are necessary? Okay. All right, at this time I would seek a motion for the school committee to approve the minutes of, motion for approval of the school committee minutes of the joint school committee and board of selectmen meeting on October 25th, 2016.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Graziano, seconded by Mrs. Birchman. All those in favor?
Yes.
And it's unanimous and so carries. Oh, sorry. Four yeses and one abstention. Thanks, Kelly. At this time, I would seek a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Kavanaugh, seconded by Mr. Graziano. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes. It's unanimous. And our next meetings are scheduled for November 17th at 7 p.m. in the high school library. And then we have our budget sessions, and we have a regular meeting on December 1st at 7 p.m. We have a special meeting on December 8th at 7 p.m. and a regular meeting on December 15th at 7 p.m., all here in the high school library. Thank you and good night.